Okay, good afternoon. Welcome to this transfer learning and domain adaptation class. I want just to remember that after the classes today, you will have a lab session on transfer learning as well. Okay. So my name is Ramon Morros, and I will present you this class on transfer learning. So the idea is that when we learn knowledge in a, for instance, in a deep learning approach, okay, the or when we the humans learn something, we don't learn every new thing from scratch. Okay, so we rely on our previous knowledge. For instance, if I know how to play classic piano, probably I will learn just piano faster than a person that does not know how to play the piano. Okay, if I have a background on some aspect, this will help me to learn new things. Okay, and if I do math, it's easier for me to learn machine learning. Or if I know how to ride a motorbike, I could learn faster to drive a car, because there is part of the knowledge that is shared among different tasks. Okay, so that's why the humans behave when we are learning. And the purpose of this class is to learn how the computers can do something similar. Okay, how can use previous experience to learn faster or better. So until now, in the last years, most of the machine learning approaches did follow an isolated single task learning. Okay, so the idea it was that we had a problem, we had some data for this problem. Probably if we are in supervised learning, we have some labels for this data, and we train our system. Okay, and once our system is trained, we can infer something about the new data that is coming. Okay, the problem is that if we want to solve a different task, for instance, I did learn something about face recognition, but now I want to work in face expression analysis. Okay, so until now, what we have been doing is to repeat the process from scratch. So the idea is that we collected new images or new data with new labels, okay, and we did perform the learning process from scratch. Okay, of course, this is highly inefficient because the learning is costly. Okay, obtaining the labels is costly. Okay, so having new labeled data is costly. So we want to minimize as possible this by reusing the previous knowledge. Okay, so in the transfer learning, the idea is that first, in the first place, we learn something in the usual approach. We have some data, a data set, some labels, and we train a system using that. But we keep this knowledge, and then we can apply this knowledge to a different task by adapting this knowledge in some way to perform faster this knowledge. Okay, faster and probably using less annotated data in the process. So for instance, as you know, when you are doing deep learning, nowadays most systems are very deep. They have a lot of layers and, of course, a lot of parameters. So if you want to train such a system, you will need a lot of data, okay, because you have to train this model having millions and millions of parameters. Okay, but what happens if you don't have millions of examples with some labels? Okay, so for instance, there is some situations, if I want to train some face identification system, probably it's very difficult to get a lot of annotated data for new people. Okay, I can get maybe 20 or 100 examples for each person, but having more than that, it's difficult. Sometimes less. Okay, if you are probably trying to recognize very known people, you can go to Google Images, put the name of these people, and have a lot of images. Okay, But if you look my name in Google, you will find three images. Okay, so and that's not enough to train a system. Oops. So the idea is that, okay, what can we do if we don't have this huge amount of data? Well, we can still do several things. For instance, one thing we can do that is not the purpose of this class is that we can learn useful representations from unlabeled data, okay? So you have some data and no labels, okay, but you can still learn some useful representation. Another thing you can do is to train on another task that is closely related to the task we are trying to solve, okay? And then transfer the representation from this related task to the new task, okay? So we can train on a similar task where we have already the labels or it's easy to get them, and then we can transfer the knowledge to our task. Okay, so the idea is that instead of training a deep network from scratch, what we will be doing is take a train network on a different domain. And now, in the following, I will define properly what is a domain, what is a task, and whatever. And then adapt this trained network to our target task, to the new task that we want to solve. Okay? So, in this lecture, we will be dealing with several ways of doing that. So, sometimes we will have the same domain, but different tasks, and sometimes we will have different domains for the same task. So, let's go for an example in visual classification. Okay, so let's say that you want to train your network on the Pascal Bok 2007. Okay, in this data set, we have 20 classes and around 10,000 images. Okay, so if we take 50% for training and 50% for test, this leaves you with 5,000 images for training. Of course, if you're trying to train a very deep network with several layers or even tens of layers, okay, you doing that, you will see that the model will overfit, because the number of parameters is much larger than the number of examples, okay? So you will see, if you try to train from scratch, you will obtain a poor performance by doing that. So what can you do? So you can train on a different data set. For instance, you can train on ImageNet. ImageNet has millions of labels and 1,000 classes, for instance. And then you can transfer the knowledge, and we can adapt this knowledge to the new domain. Okay, so in this case, the domains are different, okay, because the data sets are different. So how important is transfer learning in the deep learning community? So this is a prevision of about the importance of different parts of machine learning. Okay, of course, still the most important is supervised learning, but transfer learning is becoming more and more important, and for the industry it's a key factor, because it allows you to apply deep learning in the cases, in some practical cases, okay, where it's difficult to get a lot of annotated data. Okay, so transfer learning is what makes practical the use of deep learning in most cases. Okay, so let's start with some definitions, a little bit more formal. So first, what's a domain? A domain consists of two components. The first one is a feature space. So we define this as the feature space. It's the space where our features lay, okay, are represented. And then we have a marginal distribution. That is, for instance, the set of that is represented by the set of training vectors that we have. Okay, so this marginal distribution, roughly speaking, will tell us where the vectors from this feature space. This feature space has many possibilities, but probably in our data set, most of this feature will lay in a subset of the data set. Okay? So the, let's say, the shape of this subset or the density of this subset is the marginal distribution. How these vectors are distributed in the feature space. Okay? And for a given domain, a task is also defined by two components. So it's a set of labels and the the probability of the label given the the feature vectors. Okay? So in fact, a task is can be, for instance, a classification task. It's something that I want to classify the faces of these 1,000 different persons. So we have the labeled identities for the persons, and we have a set of feature vectors, and we have to infer the value of the label, of the identity of the person, from the feature vectors. Okay? So we have a label space, and what we have is a predictive function that, given the feature vector, will tell us which is the label. Okay, so that's everything we are doing, more or less, is related to that. We want to extract some knowledge, in this case is the label, from the data. So we take the data, we extract some feature vectors, and from these feature vectors, we train a predictive function that will tell us something about this data. Okay? And this something is defined by the task. So for instance, to have a little bit more insight in what the domain is, let's see these different representations of the number 5. As you see, these representations and these representations are quite different. Okay? So here there are 6 different representations of the number 5. And let's say that we extract a feature vector for each one, and I can plot the feature vectors in the feature space. So each triangle is a representation in this subspace. Okay, it's only two-dimensional because I cannot plot a multidimensional feature space, but each triangle is an instance of this class. Okay? For instance, if I take this other representation, these other versions of the number 5, these other versions may lay in a different part of the subspace, okay? Because they are still the number 5, but my features, the aspect of this is very different from the aspect of this. So probably in this other domain, the feature vectors are located in a different part of the subspace. So the two domains, this domain, the domain of the handwritten digits and the domain of this kind of digits may lay in a different places of the feature space. Okay, so this is a problem because I have a classifier that's trained to recognize this representation. Probably it will not work on this representation. Okay, so the domains can have different marginal distributions. This is the different marginal distributions, or also they can have different feature space. For instance, I can use a classifier or a feature extractor that will provide features, 100 dimensional features, and I can take another technique that uses 1,000 dimensional feature vectors. Okay, so in this case, we have completely different feature spaces. Okay, and also, the tasks, two different tasks, also can be different because of two different things. Usually, it's because they have different label spaces. Okay, so for instance, I'm trying to perform face recognition on this class, or on the people on this class, and I can train on the people on this class. So the labels are the identities of all of you. But if I want to recognize people in a different class, the labels will be the identities of the people in this class. Okay, so we will have different labels. So this is a can be a different task. Okay, also a different task is when it's face recognition or face expression analysis. Okay, these are examples of different tasks. So we can have different label spaces or different conditional distributions. The conditional distribution, remember that it's the probability of the label given the feature vectors, okay? Or you can have both, okay? Different conditional distribution and different label space. So in the following, what we will consider for simplicity is we will solve the problem for just two domains or just two tasks. Okay, so we'll have a source domain and a task on the source domain, and we will have a target domain and a task on the target domain. Okay, and this is the notation that I explained before. Okay, so we'll have a source that is the original domain where the first system was trained, and a target domain that is the new domain where we want to adapt the knowledge of the source domain. So we want to transfer our knowledge from the source to the target domain. And the purpose is, so let's say if we have this a source domain and a target domain, okay? So in the source domain, we will have a set of feature vectors. There are the feature vectors of the training examples. We will have some labels. Those are the labels from the training examples. And then in the in the target domain, we will have, let's say, some data. We can extract feature vectors from this data. And sometimes we will have some labels and sometimes not. Of course, if we have a lot of labels here, we can perform another training process similar to this one. Usually, what in the target domain, we have few labels or no labels at all, okay? But what we want to do is to build a classifier on the target domain. So we want to optimize the performance of the classifier on the target domain. So the idea is that we want to reduce or minimize the risk on the target domain. And the risk is the probability of misclassification for the for the vectors in the target domain, for the examples in the target domain. Okay, so we want to minimize in the target domain. And you have to take into account that because in this transfer learning approach, we'll forget, we don't care at all about the performance on the source domain after the transfer of knowledge. Okay, so this is important. In the next week, I will show you about what happens when we want to keep the performance on the target and also in the source domain. Okay, then it's a different problem. In this case, we take the source network, the source model, and we want to adapt to the target domain. And the and the goal is to optimize the performance on the target domain. Okay, I don't care what happens afterwards in the source domain. Okay. First, let's see about domain bias. Okay, so we have different domains, even for the same classes. Okay, sometimes you have what is called bias. Bias is a difference in the distribution of the different domains. Okay, this is known for a long time that the different data sets have some kind of bias. This is why you train on a subset and test on a different subset, okay? Because you want to, if there were no bias, you could train and the performance on the test set and in the training set would be the same, okay? It is not because we have some bias in the different data sets, okay? And to exemplarize this bias, Torralba, some years ago, what he called a game, that he put a website showing different images from different data sets. And the researchers had to identify from which data set came the image. Okay. So, and the if you know, I mean, if you are presented with some images of a cat, and I ask you, this image of a cat is coming from ImageNet or from Pascal Bok. Okay. And the thing is that a lot of researchers were able to discriminate, to decide from which data set the image came. Okay, so if you are capable of saying from which data set a particular image came, is that there is something special about this, the images in this data set. Okay, so there is a bias that makes it different from the images from the same class in different data sets. Okay, so this is only to show you what is the problem about this bias. Okay, so let's say that we have this bias, the domain shift, and the size of this shift is measured by the distance between the source and target distribution. Okay, the problem is that in the majority of cases we are not able to measure the distance between distributions. But if we were able to do that, we could align. There are techniques when you know the distributions of the target and the source and the target domain. There is some techniques to align the two domains, the representations in the two domains, and modify the feature extraction so that after this alignment, all the features lay in the same region of the feature space. Okay, when you align this, you can decide, you can train on these images and test on this, and you will have a good performance. Okay, because the features either from this domain and this domain are very similar. Okay, but the problem is that in most cases we don't know the distance between the distributions. Okay, so in the following, we will see several techniques to solve these problems that I put in the first class, in the first part of the class. Okay, so the first thing we can do is to do nothing at all and assume that the target domain is the same as the source domain. Okay, for instance, if we have a good enough representation, if our feature vectors are good enough in a variety of situations, we can assume that a new task or a new domain will be aligned with my source domain. And then I can use the feature vectors that has been trained on an initial task. For instance, I train in object detection in ImageNet, and maybe I can apply this for face recognition. Okay, or I can apply for another kind of problem. So the idea is that we have, this is mostly used in convolutional neural networks, okay, but also applies to other kinds of to other architectures. So what we can do, for instance, is use the network as a feature extraction, okay, and extract only the final layers. In this case, it's a convolutional neural network. So you know that there are some, usually in a classification network, there is some convolutional layers, and at the end, there are some fully connected layers that are adapting the feature vectors to the set of classes that we want to recognize. Okay, so in this case, we could this one of these layers, the output of these layers, and we have a feature vector. And then we can use this feature vector as a classical feature vector, and then we can train some kind of classifier, for instance, support vector machines or something like that, using this feature vector. Okay? And the good thing is that by doing that, this was done for the first time in 2014, okay, where Rezavian did realize that the feature vectors trained on ImageNet were capable of outperforming most techniques at this moment without doing nothing, with no adaptation at all. So We tried this on object classification, sync classification, bare subcategorization, flow recognition. So he applied for a set of different tasks and a set of different evaluations, okay? And they were able to outperform the very complicated methods that were the state of the art at this moment, the classical methods that were, for instance, in one of the in the task, they were a part annotation, regularization, then normalizing the pose, extracting features, and so on. Okay, so he was using, or they were using, only some features extracted by a pre-trained feature extractor, a pre-trained convolutional neural network, and training a support vector machines afterwards. Okay, so with that, he was able to outperform most of the state-of-the-art methods at this moment. Okay, so almost zero work, and they did win most of the competitions. So this, the conclusion was that the convolutional features were the choice in the future, for the future, in especially in image-related tasks. Okay, for classification and image-related tasks. So the idea is that, okay, we can take some pre-trained representation for our problem, but of course, if you look at this, they did achieve 80% or 76 to 80% accuracy. Okay, so can we obtain something better? Of course, I will say yes, because otherwise the class is finished and you will go away. So let's hope that it's something else to do. So the first thing is that it's called fine-tuning. In fine-tuning, the idea is that you start with a network that has been, with a model that has been trained on a particular task and domain. And you want to adapt this to another task or another domain. So remember that when you train a model, a neural network model, what you have is a set of weights that you usually initialize at random, with random numbers, and then you propagate your data through the network with this random way. You compute the output with the random weights. You compare the output with the labels, with some loss function, and then you backpropagate the error. Okay, so that's the idea. And doing that, you adjust the weights to the optimal values. But the thing is that, for instance, if you try, if you want to use this model on a different, but very, but probably similar domain or a different but similar task, the weights of the source model probably will be very close to the optimal values for the target model. Okay? So instead of training from scratch, what you can do is to start, instead of starting from random values, start from the values on the, of the weights on the source task and slightly modifying those values. So I don't have to obtain the value of the of each weight from scratch, but I can modify the value from a given point. In fact, if you think about that, it's the idea of when you are training, you are performing the backpropagation with a lot of images. Okay, so and each image refines, or each data point refines the weights of the training on the previous samples. Okay. So when you are trying to adapt this to a new domain or a new task, you assume that the weights will be close to its optimal values, and you want to just shift a little bit to achieve the final optimal final values. Okay? So in fact, this is aligning the features with the target space. Okay? So you will obtain, after this process, you will obtain a feature vector that is aligned with the target domain or the target task. Okay? You can do that on several ways. So for instance, what you can do is to freeze the weights on the first layers, and after use these weights with no modification, and then initialize randomly the last layer. Okay, so probably it's a good idea to initialize at random the last layer, because it's the one that is specific for the set of classes that you have. Okay, if you have a different number of classes or a different set of classes, you will have to change that. But what you will be doing is using this as a kind of feature extraction, and then adapting the weights on this layer for your problem, using your loss and the and the examples on the target domain. Okay? Another thing that you can do is, instead of just doing that with the last layer, it's initialize randomly the last two layers, okay, and freeze the first layers, and then you can keep trying with it the best solution. Okay. So you have two different approaches. One is to froze several layers and to replace completely the remaining ones with random random weights. And the second one is to fine-tune. Okay? In fine-tuning, it's instead of frozen, you keep the previous values and you modify slightly these values. Okay? In this way, you can avoid overfitting, because you have the number of parameters that you have to train, it's smaller. Okay? So in fact, you have the same number of parameters, but most of them are close to the final values. Okay? So with fewer training examples, you can perform this training. Okay, so which option should you try? Well, it depends also on your problem and the number of examples, of the labeled examples on the target domain that you have. If you have plenty of labeled data in the target domain, probably you should fine-tune. Okay? If you have only a few examples in the target domain, probably you will freeze most of the layers and only train the final one. Okay? And also, what you can do is to play a little bit with the learning rates, so that you can change the learning rate. So for instance, you can assign larger learning rate, higher learning rates to the layers that you want to adapt more. Okay? And we will have some, I will give some insights on how to do that. So when you are, probably you know from the last week, that when you are learning a convolutional neural network, the first layers are, if you look at the activations of the first layers, you will see that in the first ones, they are very similar to the Gabor filters. Okay, so they are very specific blobs, that something like that. And if you look at different, at the first layer on a network that has been trained on different tasks, you will see that the first layer is very, very similar. Okay? So this tells us that the first layers are generic features that usually work by detecting basic features in the image, like contours or small regions and things like that. And as you progress in the layer structure, the features that you have in each layer are more specific. So probably the first layers are very generic and the last ones are specific to your problem. So the idea is that it's wise to keep the first layers and modify the last ones. And you can do that either by freezing the first layers or by setting a very small learning rate to the first layers and a larger learning rate to the layers close near to the end. Okay, so remember that first layers are generic, last layers are class specific. Okay, but still the idea is that, okay, I know that I can do that, but should I freeze? Should I fine tune on how many layers? Okay, so there is not an answer to this question, but you can look at this paper, and they studied how transferable are the features in the deep neural networks. Okay, so and the one they did is to take ImageNet, and they split ImageNet that has 1,000 class. ImageNet is a collection of images for object detection, and each image contains one object. Okay, and there are 1,000 classes in ImageNet, so they took 500 classes for network A and 500 classes for task A and task B. Okay, so and they train one network in task A and one network in task B. Okay, and then they took the first n layers, for instance, the three for the network in class A, okay, and then they use that for fine tuning on class B, on task B. Okay, so they took the network that was trained in task A, they just took the first layers, they put the remaining layers at random, and they retrain that on task B. Okay? And this is what it's A to B. It means that taking, for instance, A and B, in this case will be A1B. This is taking the first layer of the network in task A and adapting it to task B. This is taking the first two layers, the first three layers, and so on. Okay, so the idea is that they take the task that is trained on A and they adapt it to B. And this is the and the reverse. Okay? And there is an option with B and another with B plus. So the option with B is that the remaining layers are with random weights, and the B plus is that they have the original weights and they are fine-tuned. But the idea is that this A and B is taking A and freezing one of the part and adapting to B. Freezing the first N layers and adapting to B. Okay? And if you look at the results, these points are, there are several points because they did cross-validation and did the splitting into classes in A and B several times. Okay? And they put that eight times, so there it's four times, so there are 4 points. Okay? So there are four splits on the 1,000 ImageNet classes into two subsets. So they did that, and they see that the red points, okay, if you are doing that, if you keep only freezing the first layer, everything works correct. Ah, sorry. These points are base B, so it's the network trained completely in task B. Okay? So this is the reference result, the baseline. Okay? So they see that if they only keep the first layer of task A and they train on B, the results are quite the same. If they take the first and second layers of A and train on B, you have a little penalty, and this penalty starts to increase as you go on. So this means that you keep frozen the first layers of the network in task A and you adapt to B. As you can see, there is a strong penalty here that goes on as you take more and more labels. Okay, so this, this is logical, okay, this is the logical thing, because remember, these layers are more adapted to task A, and you are using them to solve task B without they are frozen. Okay, so this is expected. Okay, this is expected the behavior. Okay. On the other side, if you look at these points, it's the same but fine-tuning, using fine-tuning. Okay, if you use fine-tuning, what you see is that you can keep or even improve the results over the baseline system. So remember, this is a network trained completely from scratch on task B. Okay? But this tells that if you take several layers from task A and you fine-tune to task B, you can achieve even better results than when you train from scratch from B. So why is that? Because this is what, what you are doing is to train more. It's like training the network with more examples. Okay, so you are training the network with examples on task A and examples of task B. And as you are fine tuning, you are adapting this network. Okay, so it's like if you did train the network for double the number of iterations, so you can get better results. Okay, and the problems in this performance drop sometimes is that the weights are in some way there is some coupling of the weights, and you cannot just cut the network and put another one without some penalty in the accuracy. Okay, so now we know that fine-tuning, of course, this only works if the tasks are more or less similar. Okay, if you are fine-tuning on completely different tasks, completely different, probably you will not get this. Okay, these results. So we know that fine-tuning, we can improve, or even we can work in situations where we have less labels than in the complete from scratch training. Okay. So fine-tuning is the main transfer learning technique that we are using. So it's quite common that if you have to train a network, the first thing you do is to see if there is someone that did train a network on a similar problem. Okay? Instead of training from scratch, what you do is there is another, there's someone that did this architecture or a similar architecture on a similar problem. If there is, you take this and use the weights. Okay? If not, you have to train from scratch. Okay, another problem that is closely related is that of domain adaptation. Sometimes what you have is two different domains, but you don't have labels on the target domain. Okay, let's start by this example. Okay, you have some data that is handwritten digits, and you have a network that has been trained to recognize handwritten digits, but now you said, okay, but now I want to recognize this kind of digits. And you try to apply the network without the off-the-shelf features, okay, and they don't work. The domains are too different, okay? You have results that are not quite good, okay? And, of course, if you have a lot of labels on the examples of the second domain, you can do transfer learning, the fine tuning. Okay, but to perform fine tuning, you need some labels here. And maybe sometimes you don't have these labels. What can you do? Okay, what can you do is this, some techniques about domain adaptation. So the idea is to train. Remember, here the problem is that we have a shift in the domain. I showed you some slides before that for this, even for the same classes, the feature vectors in domain, in the source domain are different, lie in a different part of the subspace than the feature vectors for the second domain. And what you want to do is to align the subspaces. And I told you also that if you know the distance between the distributions, you can do that, but we don't know the distance between these distributions. So what we can do? So the idea is that to align the source and target domains, what we have to do is to have features that are the same for the two domains, so that you cannot make the difference between the target and the source domain by looking at the features. So what we do is to use a domain classifier. So this part of the network is a domain classifier. It tries to determine from which domain came a particular label. You have a data point, okay, and you try to determine if it's from the source or the target domain. Okay? The idea is that if the features are representative of both domains, you will not be able to determine from which domain this particular data point comes from. So the idea here is that, for instance, for once you train a regular classification network in the common way, okay, so this is a network with a loss function at the end, and you try to minimize this loss function on the source distribution, because it's where you have annotated data, and at the same time you try to maximize domain, what is called domain confusion. Okay, so you'd have this network that it's trying to discriminate from which domain comes its data point, and you will use that to modify the weights here in order to make the features full this classification. Okay, so you want to the features to be good enough to full this classificator. Okay, so at the end, if you have a feature that is good enough, that represents in the same way, that has no shift from the two different domains, this feature vector will full this classificator. Okay? So what you do is, for once, try to separate between your classes. This is usual classification step, training. And at the same time, you try to classificate the domains, and the trick here is that when you perform this training, there is a forward pass. In the forward pass, this is just a domain classificator, and in the backward pass, okay, where you when you update the gradients, you use what is called a gradient reversal layer. This gradient reversal layer is very simple. The only thing that it does, it's multiplying by minus lambda. Okay, so this layer does nothing in the forward pass, and in the backward pass multiplies by minus lambda. So, in fact, if you put here a loss function that it's the goal is to maximize the capacity of this to classify between the source and target domains. As you are reversing the sign when you do the back propagation, what you are doing is training these weights to perform the opposite. Okay, so you are training so that the features are capable, you are, instead of minimizing the target confusion, design means that you're maximizing the the confusion between the source and target domain. Okay? So maybe you can see better this better in the loss function. So in the for this, we have two different paths for this layer, and the final loss function is a combination of this loss function and this loss function. Okay, so it's the usual cross entropy for this, for the classification part. Remember, only on the source domain, because it's only in the source domain where we have labels. And this term, that this term is negative, so minimizing the confusion, in fact, negative is maximizing it, okay? So this term tries to maximize the loss of the domain classifier, okay, because it's negative. So the feature vectors, will the this part of the training will try to minimize the loss on the domain classifier and the label predictor, minimize the loss on the label predictor, and this part will try to maximize the loss of the domain classifier. So maximizing the loss, it means that the features will maximize the confusion, okay? And for this, remember, this is a binary classifier. It only tries to tell if the input comes from one or the other domain, okay? So this way, you can, at the same time, train the network and align the features in both domains. Okay, any questions? So if you look at the results, those are the results in several cases, okay? For instance, in this case is when we train in the source domain and this one is the target domain. So the proposed approach has an accuracy of 0.8, okay? And if you train directly on the target with a lot, with classified, with a lot of labels, you obtain, okay, much better results. But, okay, remember this, that this is the proposed approach without training on the, specifically on the target domain, okay? If you use the off-the-shelf feature, so the feature vector that has been trained on the source domain, what you obtain is a much lower accuracy. Okay, so this is the accuracy that you get without domain adaptation, and this is the accuracy that you get using domain adaptation. The same for the other data sets. And you can see that the more similar the data sets are, the better accuracy you get in this process. Okay, when they are very different, you get worse accuracies. So this is not perfect. It's not capable of adapting to any domain. It works better for similar domains. OK, I'm a little bit late. Sometimes what you have is only a few annotated examples on the target domain. Then you can use what it's called the distillation loss. Okay, the distillation loss, I will skip that. It's just, remember, in the usual training process, what we do is we take random weights here in the in the network. We take a data example. We forward propagate the data example through our model, and we obtain some result. Then we compare this result. Those are the probabilities for the classification result, okay? And we compare this with the label, the one-hot encoding of the labels. We compute the multinomial logistic loss, and we backpropagate, okay? So this is the usual method. This method, okay, minimizes the importance of a single example, of a single training example. The distillation loss consists on, first, you have the, this is working from when training from the source to target domain. So First, you compute the the probabilities, the output of the softmax, for the data sample on the source domain before adaptation. Okay? And in the source domain, the probabilities are those ones. And then you do the same in the target network. And in the target network, you obtain something like that. Some random probabilities, because you have random weights at the starting here. Okay? And the training process, the distillation loss, is comparing the output with the the probabilities for the obtaining the source domain. Okay? And instead of using the the labels, okay, you are using the probabilities on the source domain. And why this is useful? Because these probabilities, if you look at these probabilities, they tell us not only which is the most likely class, but also they give us some idea about the structure of the similarities between the different classes. For instance, in this class, we have obtained a set of probabilities that say that this is a bottle, okay? But also, the second best probability is mug. So, in fact, this is like explaining that a bottle is more similar to a mug than a bottle is similar to a keyboard. Okay, so the probabilities give some idea about the similarities between classes. Okay, so using the distillation losses here, not only explains which is the the best class, but also gives some idea on the similarities between the other classes. And doing that is much more powerful than using only the label. Okay, so here with less training examples, we can perform a better training on the network. Okay, we'll skip that. So now, the idea, how we can use that for domain adaptation. Let's say that now you have two different domains and you have a few labels on the target domain. Okay, so you have few examples that with the corresponding labels on the target domain. Okay, so you can set a system that tries to minimize or the loss on the classification on the source domain, and another that tries to minimize the classification on the target domain, but this one is using the distillation loss instead of the classification loss. So in this one, instead of comparing the output of this with the one hot encoded labels, we compare it with the result of the same vector in the source database, in the source network. Okay, so we train a set of probabilities, and we train with this set of probabilities instead of the one hot encoded label. Okay, so by doing that, we are able to maximize the effect of the few training samples on the target domain. So we can achieve a better training with just a reduced set of training examples. So it's another example of transfer learning. Okay, so we are transferring the learning from the source to the target domain just by adding a few labeled samples in the target domain. This is the loss function. In fact, what you have is the standard classification loss for this one, the soft label of the distillation loss for the second part, and also you can apply the same domain confusion loss that we were applying in the first example. Okay, so you can combine standard classification on the source domain distillation loss classification in the target domain, and the confusion loss to adapt the features so that they are representative in both domains. Okay. So to conclude, remember we did learn on this class that it's possible to train very large model using a small set of data by using transfer learning and domain adaptation. Okay? Also, remember that in a lot of cases, the off-the-shelf features, the features that has been trained on a generic enough database, are a good starting point for your classification problems. Also, remember that especially the convolutional neural networks have a grading on the adaptation to a particular dataset, so that the first layers are more generic and the last ones are more specific. So remember that when you are trying to decide which parts to keep and which parts to fine-tune. And also that it's also possible to perform unsupervised domain adaptation by matching feature distributions with the last two approaches that I presented to you. Okay, so thank you very much. You have some questions? So, in the next week, I will tell you what to do when, instead of adapting the network or the model to the target domain, you want to achieve the performance, to want to keep the performance also on the surdomain. So, you don't want to lose the ability to make predictions on the surdomain, but also want to obtain good results on the target domain. Okay. So thank you very much.